Welcome back to the Digital Health and Wearables series. Today, I have another magnificent episode for you. But before I go ahead, let me remind you to subscribe to the channel and also let me acknowledge our partners, the digital health platform Clinitouch V and our industry partner, Isaac Care. And today gives me great pleasure to introduce you to Dr. Beverly Malone. She is the CEO at National League for Nursing. Dr. Beverly, how are you?
I am well. Thank you so much. I'm delighted to be here with you.
Oh, brilliant. Thank you so much for accepting the invite. I know you are busy with many different things, so delighted to have you here. So the topic that we're discussing today is the future of nursing. And the first question that I have for you is, what are the main challenges that nursing education faces at present?
It's a very important question about the main challenges for nursing education. One of the things that's been proven is that the nursing shortage that's been talked about for many years has more to do with the lack of faculty, the lack of nurse educators. The numbers, they're just not there. That one of the reasons is it's more appealing to be paid the salary that you would get in practice in a clinical area than the salary you might get at a university, a state, especially a state supported university. So having enough faculty, you can't educate students without enough faculty. And the second part of that is not having enough placements, enough areas where students can actually have the opportunity to work directly with patients. And that's because there's such competition for it. Our colleagues who are, whether they're physicians or physical therapists, everybody needs clinical placements. We need the opportunity to directly work with the people we serve. And while simulation is wonderful, you need hands-on where you get that human-to-human interaction. So those are two of the big issues that are out there for nursing education. But there's another one, and that has to do with equity in the nursing profession and making sure that the nursing profession reflects the people that we care for. And that has been something that's been ongoing. And I think we're starting to really pay attention to that and to make sure that we make some major changes to not remove it, but to mitigate it and to acknowledge it and to work with it when it's something that's getting in the way of our delivering the care that's needed for patients.
Oh, brilliant. Thank you so much for these magnificent insights and important points. And of course, I agree with you, that hands-on experience in the face-to-face interaction is invaluable. And the shortage of qualifying nurses is really a concern for healthcare. But the second question, you mentioned health equity, leads really nicely to these points. The second question that I have for you is, how do you think we can close the gap on health education and equity, and how can nursing be of help?
Well, you know, nursing is a microcosm of the rest of the world and the rest of the United States. So if you think about it that way, that the profession itself is just as you could see a mini reflection almost of the things going on in the rest of the United States. So the issues of equity are not limited to the United States. They're there in nursing also. We are people of the United States. And what we're trying to do with that is to make sure, first of all, that we have enough nurses, faculty, educators of color. They're not enough. Whether we're talking about enough students of color or we're talking about enough actual faculty educators of color, they're just not enough to go around and to reflect the patient population that we're serving. So faculty and nurse administrators like deans are very concerned about these issues and are making steps to remedy some of those issues by whether it's scholarships for those students who are in historically Black universities or predominantly Native American institutions or Native Latinx institutions, making sure that there's enough of an opportunity for those nurses coming out to have that additional education that it requires to become a nurse educator. So we're going to have more mentors of color. We're going to have more scholarship money to propel and to support those students to move toward a higher level of education so they then can teach other students.
Sure. Oh, fantastic. Great points there. And the issues that we're talking about here, of course, they're global, you know. So thanks for highlighting those important facts, actually. And the third and last question that I have for you is, what would you like to see happening in healthcare in the next 10 years?
Well, you know, if I had a magic ball and I could have a wish, I would wish that everyone would have access to healthcare. It makes such a difference in terms of mortality rates for moms and for babies. It makes such a difference in terms of finding out that you have an illness before it becomes visible in your life and in your, you know, getting that early prevention care, not just getting the care when I get sick, I go to hospital, but what about the kind of care you get in the community? So that to make sure that you stay in the community, that you don't have to go to hospital. So to me, that's all very important. I think another issue is climate. I think we're going to have to pay more attention to the climate issue and how it affects the health of the nation. Because we know that asthma in children comes from frequently being around those polluted areas where they live, and the food they eat, and all of it, the chemicals in the food, I mean, all of that has to do a lot with issues of the environment and climate. And we're going to have to really work on that issue in the future and now. I think that in addition to that, we're going to have to pay attention to the well-being of the nurse. And so we're going to have to teach about how well-being is really important, that you have to take care of yourself in order to take care of others. And nurses definitely need that. And the final thing I would say is that we're going to have some more disaster preparation for nurses in education. We don't do enough of that in the United States. In some places, like in Japan, they have a whole school dedicated to preparedness for disasters, but we have not. And yet the disasters are coming one right after the other. And so we're going to have to pay more attention and help nurses be prepared to deal with that, to work with that, to be of hope for the population for that.
Brilliant. Thank you so much for those insights. And you mentioned the sick care system that is not just in the US, but in Europe, everywhere. We are sick, we go to the healthcare system. And I think we're starting to get this broader awareness and we're slightly moving towards the direction that we need to move. Of course, is a very big challenge towards prevention, towards community care, towards home care. Now, as you can see, virtual care is everywhere. So we have many options, but it's going to take time. But I want to thank you for your time, for your amazing insights and expertise. And to finalize my episode, I always finish with a peculiar question. It's not really a question as such. It's called 1 minute of fame that you can mention anything, Dr. Beverly. You can mention professional achievements, personal life, a shout out to any company, your work, the nurses, anything whatsoever. Over to you to round up. 1 minute of fame.
I would say that there are three stressors that we all have to deal with, and nurses included. The first stressor is inevitable stress. It means aging, illness, and death. And those are always, especially for a nurse, always in the back of our mind. The second one is imposed stress, that we allow others to give us stress. And usually it's our family and loved ones, but others, like in work environments, can give us stress. And we need to give it back to them and say, that's not my stress. And the third one is chosen stress. We actually go out and choose our stresses. And so I would say that if we can manage those, I'm a psychiatric mental health nurse and a clinical psychologist. If we could manage the stress that we have, and if we could give back stress that's not ours, and if we could make better choices in terms of choosing stress, that's what I would say.
Oh, brilliant. That's so powerful and also so valuable, because we get carried away in our daily lives, the family demands, the work we need to, and yeah, the environment. And we always getting stressed, even though we're not realizing, we always getting all these influence from everywhere. And unfortunately, it comes from the forms of stress and pressure and everything else. Dr. Beverly, thank you so much for your time. This amazing, we could carry on talking for hours. This amazing time. Thanks for accepting my invite. I'm going to round up now, okay?
Thank you so much.
Thank you. To all our viewers and listeners, thank you for following. And also make sure you subscribe, acknowledge our partners, Digital Health Platform, Clinitouch V, and our industry partner, Isaac Care. And I'm going to post some links in here so you can follow the great work of Dr. Beverly Malone. She's very influential and also very active in the healthcare system. And I'll see you all next week.